Hello everyone, in this video we're going to learn how to use synthetic division to find all zeros, all real zeros of a polynomial. Okay, so as you see here, I've written positive, negative, and imaginary, and those pertain to zeros that we can have. Okay, so the first thing I would notice is that the leading term in this polynomial is x to the third. So I'm looking at this 3, and this 3 will tell me how many zeros there are in total. And this is the total number of zeros. So it means we can have real zeros and imaginary zeros, okay? Or we can have just the real zeros and no imaginary zeros at all. Okay, so let's see what it is that it is going to be. So to find the combinations of possible negative and imaginary, we have to use the Descartes Rule of Signs, okay? Rule of Signs. This is the rule in which we watch how many alternations of signs are occurring. Okay, so how many times we're changing the signs of the coefficients from one respective term to the next one in the polynomial. Okay, so we're going to look at the first term to find the number of positive. We can use the just the fx as it's given and see the changing signs. So we have the positive here, we have the positive here, so no change yet. The first change is here from the positive 3 to the negative 10, so that's 1, and then there's no change after that, right? So we can have 1 positive, 0. Now, to find the number of negative zeros, we first have to plug in the negative x into the function, into the polynomial, and see what we're going to get. So we're going to have negative x to the third power plus 3 negative x squared minus 10 negative x minus 24. And that will give us negative x to the third plus 3x squared plus 10x minus 24. And now we can study, we can inspect the number of sign changes looking at the coefficients to determine how many possible negative zeros there could be. Okay, so let's see. There's one change from the negative to positive, and then there's a second change from the positive to negative, right? So two negative zeros can theoretically exist. So now notice that 1 plus 2 is 3, right? So we've reached the maximum number of zeros. So that means we will have imaginary zeros in this scenario. Zero imaginary zeros, right? No imaginary zeros, because we already have 1 positive and 2 negative. Now, notice that in order to find the second scenario, you will have to subtract 2 each time unless there's 1. Okay, so we can only subtract from this 2, so we can have none, no negative zeros. We will still have 1 positive zero because we cannot subtract 2 from 1. But since there are no more negative zeros, we're missing 2 zeros, right? So we must assign these missing 2 zeros to the 2 imaginary ones. Okay, so in total, there will be 3 zeros, which does not violate the concept coming from the power of the leading term, 3. Okay, but let's see if we do need imaginary zeros, if there are indeed any. Okay, so we're going to use the rational root test to find the possible zeros, and then we're going to test the best zero, or we can try just to pick one and use synthetic division to confirm if it indeed is a zero. Okay, so let's do that. So let's use the rational root test. The rational root test means we will take the minus 24, find its factors, and divide it by the factors of the coefficient of the leading term, which is 1. Okay, so the factors of negative 24, so I will name it as RRT, the rational root test. So factors of negative 24 divided by the factors of 1, right, the coefficient of the leading term. So we're going to have plus minus 1, right, the factors of negative 24, plus minus 2, plus minus 3, plus minus 4, plus minus 6 now, right, because we can pair 6 times 24 to give us negative 24 and so on, right? And then plus minus 8, because that will go with 3 to give us negative 24. And then plus minus 12, that will go with the 2, right, to give us negative 24. And then plus minus negative 24, right? So that's dividing by plus minus 1, right? The factors of 1. So in this case, I'm not gonna divide by plus minus 1 because it really gives us the same thing, right? So this is your final result. There are 16 possible zeros existing for this polynomial. So from my intuition, I just think I see x to the third plus 3x squared. Something tells me that maybe 3 is a 0 or negative 3, but I will go with the 3. Okay, so we're going to use synthetic division to test whether 3 is a 0. Okay, so I'm going to put the 3 outside. Okay, and then on the top, I'm going to put the coefficients and the constants of the polynomial in order from left to right. So I'm going to have 1, right, the coefficient of x squared, and then 3, the coefficient of x to... 1 was the coefficient of x to the third, 3 is the coefficient of x squared, and then we have negative 10, the coefficient of x, and then minus 24, right, the final constant. Okay, so first we bring this 1 on the top, okay, then we multiply this 1 by 3 and add it to the top 3, okay, to find the next term. So that's going to be 3 plus 3 is equal to 6. Okay, now again, we're going to multiply 6 by 3, the divisor here. And then the product will be added to negative 10. So 6 times 3 is 18. 18 minus 10 is 8. Okay, and again, here we're going to multiply 8 by 3 to give us 24 and then add it to the negative 24. So guess what happens? Because 24, oh, sorry, I should have erased that. Okay, so 24 minus 24 is equal to 0, okay? So it means that indeed x is equal to 3, that's a 0, or we can call it a root, of this polynomial, okay? So now we can try to factor, because if 3 is a factor of this polynomial, and it is indeed a factor, because the function of 3 will give us a 0, will give us a negative 24. Okay, so... what am I saying? The function of 3, the f of 3, will give you 0, okay, as a result. You can plug it in to test. If you want to do it quickly, I can do it for you. 3 to the third power is 27. 27 plus 27, because 3 is outside and 3 is squared, so it's another 27. That's 54. 54 minus 30... and then minus 24, right? So 54 minus 54 is 0, right? So we just tested that it indeed is true. Okay, so if 3 is a factor, 3 is a 0, I don't know why I call it a factor, 3 is a 0, then x minus 3 is a factor, okay? Now, if x minus 3 is a factor, we can take it out and then find the missing pieces to give us the original polynomial, right? So let's have that. So let's have fx is equal to x minus 3. And notice that it makes a lot of sense, because if we plug the x value of 3 here, it would turn to 0, and then the missing pieces would be multiplied to 0, and the function value would be 0, just like it should be, right? When we tested the 3 and we inserted it into the function for the x. Okay, so we're going to take x minus 3 as the factor. Now find the missing pieces. So the first term is x to the third, so we have to have x squared here, right, to give us the first term. Then using the FOIL method, you see that the next term is negative 3x squared. But in the original polynomial, we have positive 3x squared, right? So we have to have a plus 6x, right? In order to give us plus 6x squared. Because negative 3x squared plus 6x squared is 3x squared, as was given in the original polynomial. Now multiplying the negative 3 with the 6x gives us negative 18x. But here we have negative 10x, so we should add 8, right? Because minus 18x plus 8x gives you precisely negative 10x, as was given in the original polynomial. And now guess what happens? This is great, because minus 3 times positive 8 is negative 24, as it should be in the original polynomial. Okay, so now we can factor this remaining piece here, this smaller polynomial, right? X squared plus 6x plus 8. So we're looking for the factors of 8 whose sum gives you 6, right? So we're going to copy down the first factor that we found. And then we're going to simply factor this smaller polynomial. Okay, so the factors of 8 whose sum is 6. So I see 4 and 2, right? So x plus 4 and x plus 2. Because the factors are 4 and 2, their sum gives you 6. So guess what? You just use synthetic division to find your factors. And when you find your factors, you find your zeros, right? So you found the first zero as 3, because when you plug in this 0, the function value is equal to 0 indeed. And this is the reason why it's called 0, right? It's an x value that makes the function turn to 0, okay? It's the x value at which the function value is 0. So that x value is called a 0. Okay, so 3 is a 0. And so we can have x minus 3 is equal to 0, or x plus 4 is equal to 0, or x plus 2 is equal to 0. So that means we have 3 zeros. X is equal to 3, or x is equal to negative 4, or x is equal to negative 2. Right? So we have 3 zeros, as indeed was originally suspected when we looked at the leading term with the power of 3 of the original polynomial. We knew that we would have to have 3 zeros, whether they're positive, negative, or imaginary. The total number of zeros should be 3, and that's indeed true. In this case, there are 2 negative zeros and 1 positive, and that's exactly what was given in the first scenario. Notice 1 positive, 2 negative, and that's what we got. Thank you so much for watching. I hope this was helpful. Please subscribe, and I'll see you in my next video.